Divine Truth Interviews. Jesus, Mary, and others are interviewed by members of the media and the public. Jesus is interviewed by Mary Magdalene on the topic of Divine Truth. The interview was held on the 29th of September 2013 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 5.
Welcome to the fifth session of discussing divine truth qualities, or you could say the qualities of God's truth. And if we look at the last few sessions that we've done, we can see that basically we talked too much and therefore couldn't cover everything that we hoped to cover. So this particular session, we are hoping to cover the last couple of qualities of divine truth. So that'll be four questions, and then have one more question about living in truth and what it means to live in truth. With the other sessions, this will sort of round out all of the sessions on the divine truth questions. There's still over 100 questions associated with the divine truth subject that we haven't covered, but we felt that we wanted to cover these qualities of divine truth first because it helps overcome the questions of how do I determine what is God's truth and what isn't. So that's our primary purpose today. So I hope you enjoy our session today. And I think this time we will get through the four questions we have to answer. Thanks, guys.
Quality 13. Mm-hmm. What do you mean when you say divine truth is felt, it is emotional?
Yes, I feel this again is a very important quality of God's truth in that it is not something that you can intellectually accept. It's something that has to also be emotionally accepted. A lot of people seem to believe that they can intellectually accept God's truth and then try to put into practice God's truth in their personal life. And that's actually not possible. Mm-hmm. It has to be an emotional experience. And if you're trying, then it means you're not going through the emotional experience. The soul is automatic once we go through the emotional experience. It's automatic that we practice God's truth once we've gone through the emotional experiences of clearing away the soul's error. And if we have to try, then it means it hasn't been an automatic process, and therefore it can't be God's truth. It has to be, it's not yet accepted in the soul as God's truth. It might be accepted intellectually, but it's not been accepted in the soul. There's also this issue of having to try with regard to God's truth. The reason why we have to try is because we only have the truth intellectually. And this is going to be a problem for the rest of our life if we're not careful. And we can only progress to a certain degree by trying intellectually because the actual soul change has not occurred. And the only way a soul change can occur is something has to be felt. So error has to be felt and truth has to be felt. There is no other way that you can have a truth enter your soul without it being felt, and there's no way for an error to leave your soul without it being felt. Mm. So all of God's truths must be felt before they can be truly acknowledged as a part of your own experience. Before that time, you basically just have to try intellectually to understand it. But there is going to be some major problems with that because the intellect isn't designed to understand all of God's truths. The human intellect usually exists within the spirit body of the person, and the spirit body is only able to intellectually understand God's truths to the point of the sixth dimension. So any truths that are above the sixth dimension cannot be understood without feeling them. Mm-hmm. And because for that reason, divine truth must be felt. It is an experience that we have to have rather than just thoughts that we have. And this is what I feel, or where I feel, the majority of the Earth's religions and religious practices have gone wrong. Most of the Earth's religions have focused on the intellectual acceptance of God's truth or attempting to intellectually accept God's truth. And it's quite obvious that they haven't emotionally accepted God's truth, because if they had, then they would not war with each other. They wouldn't promote violence. They wouldn't even argue with each other about their differing opinions. They would present what they believe, perhaps. But if divine truth was felt, what eventually happens is everyone finishes up with the same belief. It's like everybody will eventually finish up having the same belief about gravity. Mm-hmm. And gravity is one of God's truths. And so from a physical perspective, we accept that everyone will eventually finish up having the same belief about things like gravity, aerodynamics, and all the other scientific principles of the universe. And it's time that we started to understand that we will eventually have the same beliefs about love, right? Mm-hmm. And we'll eventually have the same beliefs about God's universal truths relating to the spirit body and to the soul of the individual and the emotional content of the individual. So we'll eventually have the same belief systems. It doesn't mean that we'll have the same expression. We'll have the same belief systems. If we are differing in opinions to others and differing in our opinion to God's truth, mm-hmm. then of course it's impossible for us to have the same opinion as God on any matter. And this is something that we need to do. We need to come to accept God's opinions on the matter.
And you're saying, though, that the only way we are going to do that, or the world globally is going to do that, is through a feeling process.
Exactly.
So it's not a matter of just hearing something and adhering to a doctrine.
No.
The truth has to be felt within the soul
yes.
of the person, not even the spirit body, but the soul of
yes.
the person.
And a person, if you understand that love is an emotion, to actually feel the sensation of love, you have to feel an emotion. Mm-hmm. So, and if we understand that all of God's truths are loving, then of course it means that all of God's truths are also emotional. They have to be felt.
Yeah.
So while we might come to accept certain physical truths intellectually, in the reality, we also come to accept them emotionally. So pretty much everyone on the planet at the age of 2 to 3 years of age, by that stage, accepted the truth about gravity emotionally. Mm-hmm. They realised that every time they tried to bend the laws of gravity, some hurt occurred, some emotional experience occurred, and so they've come to accept in their soul the truth about gravity mm-hmm. from an emotional perspective, from an experiential perspective. It's the same with all of God's truths. To come to terms with all of God's truths, we are going to have to experience every single one of them emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
We can't expect to go through a process of intellectually hearing them and then knowing them. And what I see a lot of people doing with our seminars is they think they know God's truth, and yet they've yet to have an emotional experience to release the errors that block them from knowing God's truths. And so it's impossible for them to actually know God's truths in that state. As a result, it's impossible for them to be loving. Mm. And that's why many of them are still very unloving.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible for them to express love and receive love under those conditions. And it's also impossible for them to accept God's truths under those conditions.
Mm.
So it's very, very important that we understand that this emotional experience is essential to our progression.
Mm.
Without it, no progression can actually occur.
Mm.
The soul is built to progress only through an emotional experience.
And so you said earlier that change would be automatic once we have this feeling process.
Yes.
Are you also saying it will be permanent?
Yes. So once we've actually released the emotional error, which will be an emotional experience every time, and once we accept God's truth on the particular thing that we're experiencing, which will also be an emotional experience every time,
mm-hmm.
then the truth will be in our soul. It'll be a part of our very being. As a result of that, it's impossible for us to act against it without experiencing a lot of pain. And so we automatically then tend to operate in harmony with it. And as a result, we do things all the time without having to try to do them.
Yeah.
We are automatically doing them. We're automatically being loving. We automatically know what the truth is under those circumstances.
Mm.
So it's really important that we understand that it's impossible for us to intellectually receive God's truth without going through some kind of emotional experience, and for us to understand it. And I feel there's still a deep misunderstanding about that in almost everybody that listens to our presentations. They still believe they can go through some kind of intellectual experience of understanding the truth without it being an emotional experience.
Yeah.
And that's impossible.
Yeah.
And this is one of the qualities of God's truth. And what I love about it is that it in a way, it precludes the intellectual experience. So unless it's an emotional experience, there is no way that we're going to discover God's truths on a particular subject.
Mm.
And this is a very beautiful way that God's made the universe, that we're going to have to experience the universe to understand the truth, rather than just think we know.
Yeah, and try to understand it with our thoughts.
Our thoughts, yeah. And in fact, there are many, many spirits in the spirit world below the sixth dimension, well, the sixth dimension and the below, who have no knowledge of the majority of God's truths, particularly the major truths influencing the soul. And the reason why they have no knowledge, even though they have highly developed intellects, is because they have denied the emotional experience. They don't understand this particular quality of God's truth, and that divine truth has to be felt rather than just intellectually heard.
Mm. Mm. Okay. What if a truth requires us to actually deny emotion or to distance ourselves from emotion? Because we see that a lot, don't we?
Yes. Yeah. So if somebody is presenting to us an idea or a concept as the truth or as God's truth, if we have to deny the emotional experience, a positive emotional experience, in order to receive it, then it means it can't be God's truth. It just has to be a man-made idea.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps I can give some illustrations of that from a religious perspective initially. Yes. From a religious perspective, many Christians would say that I died for their sins. Now, if we look at this from an emotional perspective rather than just an intellectual one, just is it that I'm looking for? Just is it for one person to die for the sins of many? Like, you would never ask your own child, who was a good child, to die for the sins of the child, even if it was your own child, another child, who had made some kind of error. You would ask the child who made the error to pay for its own sin.
Mm-hmm.
So, and in fact, if a parent, in our current day and age, if a parent blamed one child who did not sin, let's call it, or did not commit the wrongdoing, for the child who did commit the wrongdoing, we would view them as a very unloving parent and a very unfair parent. And interestingly enough, we would probably be quite upset with that parent about the injustice that the parent has perpetrated. Ironically, when it comes to the same reasoning about God, we think that God's going to be unjust.
Mm.
And that's not true at all. God is never going to be unjust. And in fact, the very thought of it rebels against the emotion of where's the justice for the person who's having to pay for the sins, in this case, myself. If I'm meant to have paid for the sins of everybody, if Jesus is meant to have paid for everyone's sins, then where's the justice for Jesus? There is none, right? And therefore, from an emotional perspective, that particular teaching cannot be true. It cannot be God's truth. It has to just be a man-made idea. In fact, man-made ideas are full of injustice and full of, you know, intellectual thinking without actually feeling through the process emotionally.
Do you also feel within that common, widely held belief that you died for people's sins? Certainly there's a distancing from the natural kind of emotion that we would have about how unjust is that.
Yep.
But also, is it not a way to distance myself from my own compensation for things that I've done emotionally by saying, actually, I just need to believe in Jesus' blood and I don't actually have to deal with that.
Yes, I feel people have a justification for it. I don't know if that relates to our topic, but...
I thought I was just talking about the distancing from emotion, that belief
Of course it distances fosters, from emotion. Basically, it's saying... But it's also distancing the individual from responsibility, from personal responsibility.
Sure.
So it distances the person individually who believes in that belief from a lot of personal things that they need to go through, taking responsibility for their own life, feeling about it from an emotional perspective, feeling about it from Jesus' perspective, how would he feel having to pay for these sins, and feeling about it on a number of levels. And what I'm suggesting is if you feel about the particular doctrine that's being presented to you as God's truth, and it rebels against the feelings. In other words, you would prefer to, if you were placed in the situation personally, would you feel it was fair?
Mm.
And if you wouldn't feel it was fair personally, placed in the situation, then why is it fair for Jesus?
Sure.
It's not fair for Jesus, obviously. And as a result, it rebels against the emotion. Now, of course, people do have emotions that would cause them to want other people to pay for their errors,
yeah.
but they're not very just. And in fact, in this day and age, we have a whole set of laws of the land which stop you from actually paying the price for somebody else's wrongdoing.
Yeah.
Right? So, you know, if man-made laws do not allow it, and then we assume that God's laws do, then we have some pretty amazing thinking to adjust, because the reality is what we're doing is we're assuming that God is worse than the most loving person on earth.
Yeah.
The reality is all of God's laws are much higher and therefore more just and more loving than any person's laws on earth. And if on earth we would rebel against the thought of you paying for my wrongdoing, then we should also rebel against it from a religious or a spiritual concept. And that is an indication of how, or an example of how we need to look at this particular truth. This particular truth is telling us that unless we feel, and we feel it's all right,
mm-hmm.
we feel it's all in harmony, it's all balanced, it's all ethical, unless we can feel that in whatever is presented to us, it is not God's truth.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite simple. Yeah.
Sure. Okay, just some things from the notes here. You contrast personal truth or a soul's truth with divine truth in
yes.
terms of emotion.
Well, let's look at it from a soul's perspective. What is the soul's truth? In other words, what is my soul's truth? Well, that's my beliefs, my desires, my passions, my emotions, my love principle, you know, the expression of my love, that's my truth, right? From God's perspective, God's truth is God's emotions, God's desires, God's passions, God's love, and all of the things associated with God. That's God's truth.
Mm-hmm.
So really it's quite simple. We can look at those two things and say, well, okay, for myself, I am going to have to experience some kind of emotional experience before I can absorb truth and before I can release whatever is the opposite of truth or error within me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to have to go through the emotional experience. It's going to involve my emotions, my passions, my desires, my longings, and the love that's within me to do that. I'm going to have to engage that. From a point of view of receiving God's love, we need to understand that God has emotions, desires, passions, longings, and love, and we have the ability to receive these particular emotions, and I am going to have to go through a process of bringing my truth into harmony with God's truth before that can occur. And the way I do that has to be emotional, because God's love is emotion,
mm-hmm.
and emotion from God.
Mm-hmm. And even you're saying that truth is centered emotionally within
exactly.
God and within us.
Yes.
So, and
without it being an emotional experience, it doesn't actually exist in reality inside of our soul. That's the truth.
It's quite an amazing statement, really, isn't it?
That's
correct. It's actually saying all of this busyness that goes on up here,
uh-huh.
unless there's an emotion attached to it or that I'm experiencing, it doesn't even exist.
Exactly. It's not even real yet. It's not even real yet.
Yeah.
It has barely any, if any, effect on my life. It has barely any effect on how I feel, because it hasn't entered my soul yet. It has barely any effect on how I feel, and it has barely any effect in terms of what I can transmit to others. Unless I feel it, nobody else can feel it from me either. So I can think that I love them, but if my feelings are such that would, you know, be opposite to that in some manner, then I don't love them.
Mm.
You know, the feeling I'm having is a completely different feeling,
mm.
whatever that feeling might be. When the feelings are true, then you could say another person should be able to then feel that feeling, as long as they are open to the reception of that feeling. So just because I love you, it doesn't mean that you will be open to reception of that love. There's got to be an opening in your soul, an emotional experience in your soul for you to receive that particular love. And the same applies to God. Just because God loves you, it doesn't mean that you're going to automatically receive God's love. Unless you feel something, you're not going to receive it. Simple as that. So you can think that you're praying for God's love. You're not going to be receiving it until you're feeling something for God's love to enter you. And you'll actually feel the emotion as God's love, and you'll be overwhelmed with emotion. It'll be an emotional experience. You can't avoid it.
Yeah.
And if you're trying to avoid it, you cannot receive God's love. Simple as that.
Mm.
If you're trying to avoid the emotional experience, you cannot receive it. And that's something that we need to understand. We cannot receive God's truth or God's love without there being an emotional experience.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so then how do we analyse truth if, from what you've just said, it doesn't really exist if we're just thinking about it?
In terms of how do we analyse it?
What is true? How do we analyse what is
well,
true?
Well, if we look at this particular quality, basically what we're saying is the way to analyse truth is to work through the emotion.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're saying. So we're saying that you're going to have some kind of emotional analysis of everything that you receive, not just an intellectual one.
Mm.
And if you think about the truths that are established from a physical perspective again, so if we go back to gravity as an example, the emotional analysis of gravity usually happens when the child starts walking. So it's an automatic process, basically. The child starts walking, it has a, you know, it has an unbalanced, then it starts making a few steps and then it falls flat on its face. It has a big cry, starts to feel the effect of gravity on itself. And then it knows that if it gets up higher or climbs up something and falls down, there's more hurt than it hurts more. So therefore it understands that the higher you go, the more it hurts, right, if you don't obey the law. And so you start taking care with the law of gravity automatically.
Mm-hmm.
And you do it automatically because it's been an emotional experience. So it's not something, and it doesn't matter how much a parent says to the one-year-old, you've just got to be careful now how you're walking, you know. It doesn't matter how much the parent tries to explain that to the child. Until the child goes through the personal emotional experience, it will not have a respect for that law of gravity. It will not have a feeling for the law of gravity. It won't have a feeling for its own safety. It won't have a feeling and an experience every time there was pain when it tried to break the law. It won't have any of those things. And that's why every child goes through the experience, even though the parent knows the law of gravity herself or himself.
Yeah.
And so if we look at that, the way to analyse the universe from a larger perspective is to analyse it in the same manner. We look at everything from an emotional perspective as well as a logical, intellectual one. And the two have to meet each other. There has to be an agreement between the emotional and the logic. The emotion has to have a logical explanation in it, and always will with God's truth. Everything is like that with God. So every truth of God always has a resonance with the emotion as well as with the logic.
Mm. Yeah.
And by the way, if you preclude the logic, then obviously there's a problem as well. So if you're precluding logic in the analysis and you're only having the emotional experience, then that's also a problem. But that's not the main problem that most people on earth have. Most mm-hmm. people on earth prefer intellect and preclude the emotion.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. Okay, what about if we have emotional errors still inside of us? Can we see truth then?
No, again, it's like the emotional error that exists within inside of us is basically like a wall. It's an emotional wall that prevents the absorption of emotional truth on the same subject. So as we have said in How the Human Soul Functions, which is another set of frequently asked questions that we answered, if inside of our soul we have an error emotionally on a certain subject at a certain time, then at that particular time, on that particular subject, none of God's truth can enter us, because all of God's truth on the subject is going to be emotional as well.
Mm.
And the two emotions are in complete opposition to each other. The emotion of error opposes the emotion of truth. So the only way we are going to be able to absorb the actual truth, no matter what we think in our intellect, the only way our soul is going to be able to absorb the truth is by first going through the process of emotionally releasing the error. Once the emotional release of the error has occurred, now we have the ability to emotionally absorb the truth.
Mm.
And this is why it's so important to understand this particular principle about God's truth. Because if we think that we can with our mind absorb God's truth while at the same time retaining an error in the soul about the same subject, then we are just deluding ourselves. And also, it is impossible for us to, under those circumstances, automatically change and automatically do what the truth dictates.
Mm.
So what we need to understand instead is that God's truth is such that it is emotionally felt and experienced. If I'm not emotionally feeling it and experiencing it, then it means that I have an error within myself that is also an emotion that needs to be experienced before that emotional experience of God's truth can enter me.
Mm.
Yeah. And so we need to understand this relationship between how we block, how our soul blocks the absorption of God's truth. And one of the primary ways it blocks it is by not allowing the emotion. That's one of the ways that the majority of people who have heard divine truth for many years, the reason why they do not progress as rapidly as they could is because they are usually constantly blocking the emotion.
Yeah.
And when you're blocking the emotion, it is impossible to receive new truth.
Okay, just a final part from your notes here.
Mm-hmm.
You said eternal growth towards universal truth is only possible when we have emotional intelligence.
Mm.
What do you mean by this emotional intelligence?
Well, emotional intelligence, if I could perhaps define the term as I would express it,
mm-hmm.
emotional intelligence is your emotions in complete harmony with logic. It's not just emotions expressed without any intelligence or logic.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, the emotion of anger to me is not an expression of emotional intelligence. Right? It's an emotion of error that we need to have leave us, so we need to let it flow out of us. And if we have emotional intelligence, we would understand that the anger needs to flow out of us.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore we would allow its experience in a safe environment, but we would allow it in such a way where it wouldn't harm another. So in other words, we wouldn't all of a sudden get into a rage and decide to murder somebody. If we had emotional intelligence, we could not do such a thing. And the reason why is because there would be other emotions inside of us that say it is wrong to murder somebody. It's taking away their will. It's taking away their life. It's putting them in our control, which is not something that would be in harmony with love. And for that reason, we would automatically feel that it's impossible to go and murder somebody under any circumstance, even if they tried to murder ourselves or murder our loved ones. We would still feel it was impossible if that particular belief was in our soul. So it's very important for us to see that if we had emotional intelligence, what we would be able to do is absorb, we would know that we have to let go of truth, let go of error in order to receive truth.
Mm-hmm.
And the process of letting go of error is an emotional experience. And we would also know that the process of absorbing God's truth is an emotional experience. And if we have emotional intelligence, we would know that. We wouldn't fight the process. Now, what I see a lot of people doing is fighting the process tooth and nail. They spend a lot of their life avoiding the process with their intellect or fighting that process. That is an indication that there is little emotional intelligence present. We need to develop some emotional intelligence if we're ever going to understand all of God's universal truths. The reason why is, as I've said, up until the sixth dimension, it is possible to receive truths intellectually and try to do something different and actually make some changes over long periods of time. However, the soul has yet to really fully change.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way full change can occur is for the soul to go through the emotional experience of releasing its error so that it has the emotional capacity to understand God's truth. That is a process that will need to be engaged by every single person who ever wants to become at one with God. If we don't engage that process, we are not really displaying emotional intelligence. We might be thinking that we're intellectually intelligent, but the reality is for a person to be happy completely, there needs to be some emotional intelligence. And in fact, once they're happy completely, there'll be complete emotional intelligence, just like their intellectual intelligence will be completed to a large degree as well.
Mm.
So they'll, at that point, have the ability to absorb new information because there is no blockage emotionally to the absorption, because all of the emotional error that prevents the absorption has been released.
But first we need to allow this emotional process to
exactly commence. Yeah. Just like the child goes through the experiential process when it discovers the law of gravity, we need to allow ourselves to go through the experimenting and experiential process to find all of God's truths, mm-hmm. all of them.
Mm-hmm.
So if you like, we're engaging an emotional process of discovering truth. That's what we're doing. And we need to understand that that's what we're doing. It's not just an intellectual, how does this work, how does that work? It's an emotional feeling about how it all works, and a knowing as a result, because we've released the error, once the truth enters us, we know how it all works. And it's very, very easy for us then to put it into practice. In fact, it's impossible for us to not put it into practice under those circumstances. So everyone who's struggling to love has yet to engage that particular process. They're yet to understand that God's truth is always going to be felt. It's always going to be an emotional experience.
Yeah.
If you're struggling to practice it, it means that there is an emotional blockages of error within that need to be released. And why would it be that you're not experiencing this error? Well, that's because you have a belief that the intellect should be dominant over the emotion. And that's not the way God created the soul. So God created the soul as we see it expressed in the child. And you can see the child goes through the experiential process. So it doesn't matter how much the parent, you know, lectures the child about something, some kind of danger, sooner or later the child will only discover that danger through its own experience.
Mm. Mm.
And that is the beauty of the way God's made it. If we understood all that from the beginning, we would have less intellectual engagement of what's going on in terms of what is truth, what isn't, and we wouldn't have these large debates about what is truth and what isn't. We would have more emotional engagement. We'd be looking at everything that's coming to us and we'd go, okay, I hear that person presenting to me what that person believes is a truth. Let me analyse this truth from an emotional perspective. Does it make sense to my emotional intelligence? Not just to my intellect, not just to my logic. Because there's a lot of seemingly logical things that are presented that as soon as you allow yourself to analyse them from a heart perspective, from an emotional perspective, you can instantly dismiss them. And that applies to the majority of spiritual teachings on this planet. You could instantly dismiss them if you analyse them just through this particular perspective.
Mm. Mm. Regarding quality 13,
mm-hmm.
what does a soul-based understanding that divine truth is felt, it is emotional, look like in my day-to-day life?
Well, firstly, we would not try to do anything. We would understand that if the process with God is not, with regard to love, is not automatic. In other words, I do not understand God's laws automatically, then it means that there's an emotion I have to experience that opposes my understanding. Not an intellectual understanding that I've got wrong, but rather an emotion that I've got inside of myself that's out of harmony with love or truth. If I understood that the wrongness, if you could call it that, is emotional and not intellectual,
mm.
it's not a lack of intellectual knowledge, then I would have a lot better understanding about this particular quality.
Yeah.
So in my day-to-day life, I wouldn't try to do everything or anything. I wouldn't be using my intellect to make decisions. I wouldn't be changing just my actions. I would instead want to work, I want to feel every feeling that I actually have on that particular subject. And when I noticed the feeling was out of harmony with love or truth, I would wish to release it from myself. And I wouldn't resist that process if I understood this quality. I would love that process. I would actually engage that process willingly. So as you know, there's not many people on the planet who yet love that process. Mm. And so they, therefore they've yet to have a soul understanding of this particular divine truth.
Yeah. All right, some things from your notes.
Sure.
I think you just covered this one. I do not try to live in divine truth, rather I feel divine truth as emotions within my soul.
Yep.
I understand that if I'm trying, it is because I'm yet to actually make the soul change needed.
And that's a very important understanding to get at the soul level, to understand that if you are having to try and if you are having to change your actions, but you still have a longing in your soul to keep doing the previous thing you were doing that you know was unloving, then it means that there's yet to be a soul-based change. So for example, a person who's smoking decides to stop smoking. So they stop smoking, but they still feel like they'd like to have a cigarette. That is an indication that nothing's changed at the soul level. The cause of them desiring the cigarette in their soul has not changed. It's like a person who wants to drink, to get drunk all the time. If the change hasn't been made in the soul, then you'll feel drawn back into that pattern of behaviour, no matter how much of an intellectual change you've made. Mm-hmm. This is why New Year's resolutions don't work very well, yes. Generally. Most people, you know, they sit there on New Year's Day or New Year's Eve, they go, oh, I want to change my life. I want to have some, you know, new experiences this year that I haven't had last year. I want to be more good to myself. And, and usually it's after a whole couple of weeks first of being bad to themselves they get to this point. And then what they do is they go, okay, I'm going to make some resolutions. Mm-hmm. Usually by 2 or 3 days into the new year, most of those resolutions are out the window. And the reason why is that we can intellectually think our way through things as much as we want. Unless there's going to be some soul-based change, no change is really going to be very easy to engage.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. So unless we have a big cry on New Year's Eve or New Year's Day...
about the subject that we want to change,
yeah.
It's highly unlikely the next day there will be a change.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. I always see that there's an emotion within me when I'm out of harmony with divine truth.
Yeah, so whenever I see, let's say in my intellectual analysis, my logical analysis, I see that God does a certain thing, but I don't do it. Or God seems to have an understanding a certain way, but I don't seem to have that particular understanding. Instead of trying to change my mind on the subject, I need to change my soul on the subject. And the only way that a soul can change is by going through an emotional experience of releasing the error to absorb the truth. I understand that. I don't avoid that. I don't think myself away from that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't try and intellectually reason that I should be able to avoid the pain of the error. I don't try to get away with the error. I allow myself to go through the experience. That's what I would do if I had a soul-based understanding of this quality of God's truth.
Yeah.
I would also choose actively to feel the emotional experience rather than choosing actively to avoid it. So I see a lot of people doing that. There's a choice actively to avoid it. We start discussing a truth, the emotion starts rising in the person of error, you know, the error starts coming out, and they start shoving it back down and suppressing it. Well, that's because there's no soul-based understanding of this particular divine truth,
mm-hmm.
that all of God's truth is going to have to be felt. You're going to have to allow the emotional experience.
Yeah, absolutely. So we actually want to identify and experience the emotions that are out of harmony with love.
Yes, in fact, it becomes our first point of concern
mm-hmm.
in every aspect of life. So let's say something bad happened to us today. Let's say we had a car accident. Instead of trying to fix this accident from an intellectual perspective, or fix the results of this accident from an intellectual perspective, I am going to be focused emotionally on why did this accident occur? There's got to be something in my soul that caused this particular thing. If we look at it from a perspective of a disease, a lot of people catch severe diseases like, you know, something like AIDS or cancers or heart disease or, you know, that are life-threatening. And what they have a tendency to do is they have a tendency to go and change their life, but not change their emotion. Now, if you change your life, sometimes it will trigger some changes in emotion and therefore some benefits. But a lot of the times, if you don't change something emotionally, you will continue with your cancer. Your cancer will worsen, or AIDS will worsen, or whatever it is that is the disease that you've got will worsen. It won't improve. Mm. It can only improve by releasing the emotional error that creates it. And while I'm focused intellectually on changing my diet, changing my day-to-day practices without going through any emotional experience, it's highly unlikely I will find a cure except medically. But if I go through the emotional experience, it's highly likely I will be cured. Mm. But we need to understand that the fact that we've got a disease is telling us how shut down we are emotionally. So it's already telling us how resistive we are to experiencing the emotions that create the disease. Otherwise, the disease wouldn't have gotten created. So this is an indication, the fact that we have the disease is an indication that we have huge amounts of resistance and huge amounts of addictions to go through that we have up to that point in time been unwilling to go through. And we need to be willing to go through it if we're ever going to have a soul-based change on the subject. Mm. So I wouldn't be, even if I had a headache, my first port of call wouldn't be a painkiller. My first port of call would be, okay, what emotion am I suppressing now? Like what experience out of harmony with love and truth, God's love and truth, have I had inside of myself that I am not allowing myself to feel about that's causing this particular headache that I've got? That'd be my first and probably, once I understood this truth, my only port of call with regard to trying to solve the problem.
Yeah.
The majority of people don't do that. What the majority of people do instead is they've instantly looked for the physical cure. And then once they have the physical cure, they have no desire to find the emotion. And that emotion is going to stay within the soul, preventing the access to God's truth. Mm. So I find that very unfortunate. Mm. So this is something we need to understand with regard to this particular quality.
Yeah. Mm. So following on from that, I suppose, is in your notes, I do not intellectually deny nor falsify my own condition to myself.
Exactly. So I'm not there telling myself that, you know, the accident that happened today was caused by somebody else. I'm not there telling myself that this disease that I've got can be cured physically. I'm not there telling myself all the errors from God's perspective. I'm telling myself the truth. Everything has an emotional connection. There's a reason why I've gotten this particular thing or had this particular experience that's been painful, and it's always going to have something to do with my emotion, always going to have something to do with it. And I will want to know what that was instead of trying to find out some intellectual solution. Mm. And it surprises me still that people who have come along to sessions for 5 or 6 years about divine truth still try to have the intellectual solution. And this is an indication of how frightened they are of their emotional experience and also how they do not yet understand this basic quality of God's truth, that without the emotional experience, you cannot receive God's truth,
yeah,
actually. And this is... So my feelings are, I want to go through the experience, not avoid it. Why would you want to avoid it when the experience, the emotional experience, is the only way you're going to discover the truth? Why would you try to avoid the emotional experience if you knew that? Of course you wouldn't.
Mm-mm.
So every time that we are trying to avoid the emotional experience, we are really reminding ourselves that we as yet do not understand quality 13 of divine truth, this quality that divine truth, God's truth, has to be felt and experienced before we'll be able to understand it.
Yeah, mm. Yeah. Okay. I emotionally understand that I cannot teach the divine truth if I cannot feel it.
Yes, it makes sense that if I cannot feel divine truth personally in my soul and therefore automatically act upon it, then I'm pretty hypocritical attempting to teach it to somebody else, right?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I'm just teaching them an intellectual concept.
Yep.
Because the only way they're going to learn God's truth is to go through an emotional experience that I have yet to go through. So any person who attempts to teach another person God's truth while at the same time denying their own personal emotional experience is basically a hypocrite. Yeah. They do not yet understand the importance of the emotional experience. And divine truth is all about the emotional experience. So yes, it's impossible really to teach another person something that you yourself have yet to personally experience. Mm. You might be able to say to them things like, well, I've been told, blah, 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 you know, but I've yet to experience it. But I think that the reason why I'm yet to experience it is because I can feel this emotion inside of me of error that's telling me to do the other thing. Yep. You know, we could maybe say things like that, but we can't be dogmatic about what is God's truth or firm about what is God's truth without having gone through the emotional experience ourselves. And if we are, then I would suggest to the person that then their dogmatism or their firmness is not based around love or their personal experience, but based around some other kind of fear that they have.
Yeah, yeah. And related to that, I emotionally understand that I cannot assist another with truth if I am yet to feel it myself.
Yes. So how can you help another person understand the truth about themselves when you're yet to go through the emotional experience understanding the truth about yourself? And I see this happening constantly with people. There are a lot of people engaging mediumship, for example, who do this. Mm-hmm. They are telling other people what they believe is truth or what the spirit believes is truth when the person who's the medium has yet to gone through the experience. Mm-hmm. Now, it's highly unlikely, if that's the case, that the person who's the medium is actually saying the right thing to the person who's yet to go through the experience as well. The medium first needs to go through the emotional experience themselves, and now they're open to the truth. And in being open to the truth, then they're then going to attract spirits who are also open to the same truth, that divine truth has to be felt. And they won't be focused on telling the person something about their life that's completely a furphy or something that misleads them. They'll be more honest and truthful about what's really going on for the individual. Mm. It's impossible to assist somebody else when you've yet to go through the emotional experience. So just give up doing that. You know, like stop believing that you can teach somebody else how to love unless you have learned how to love yourself. Stop believing that you can teach somebody else about some kind of God's truth unless you've felt that truth inside of your soul. Because if you haven't felt it inside of your soul, it's impossible to teach it.
Mm. Mm. Okay. Last one, I understand that unless I feel, my understanding of the universe will be flawed.
Exactly. This is one of the infinite things that we need to understand about emotion. Emotions are such that they can grow infinitely. So in other words, our soul has been made by God to receive God's love, which is an emotion, and this love that we receive from God transforms our soul in its capacity to receive more truth. In other words, without love and emotion, we don't have the capacity to expand and therefore receive more and more of God's truth. Mm-hmm. Now, if we really understood that, we would see that there was going to be a limit to our intellectual understanding of the universe if we don't engage emotionally. We are going to understand certain things and be fascinated by certain things, but in the end, there will be a ceiling beyond which we will never be able to go unless we go through some kind of emotional experiences. God has made it that way, that there are certain parts of the universe and certain parts of your own self that you cannot understand at all with your intellect, and you must go through a personal emotional experience to understand. Mm-hmm. Now, humankind does that pretty naturally from birth. But unfortunately, by the time a child is 7 years of age, generally that's been heavily suppressed, that experiential process. And that's our problem, is that because we've now suppressed it and we believe the intellect should dominate, we have now prevented our universal and infinite expansion of our own soul. Mm. And that is a sad fact, unfortunately. So there are many people who are very intellectually clever and intellectually aware that have very little emotional experiences of God's truth, And they will remain in such a condition until they allow themselves to start going through the emotional experience. And when they do, their capacity to understand even intellectually will grow beyond that point. Because the soul engages the process far differently to the intellect. And as a result, it creates opening pathways inside of the soul that allows us to absorb more of God's truths, because we now have absorbed enough love to understand them. In other words, we've come to be in harmony more and more with the universe around us because we've come to be more loving. And as a result, we've come to understand more of God's truth than we understood before. And in fact, if you don't transform with regard to love, you will not understand. There's certain things that it's impossible to understand, in fact. And it doesn't matter how much you exercise your intellect, you will not understand them. It's only when you engage this emotion of love that you'll actually be able to understand them. So if we look at that particular quality, you see, again, it's a pretty important quality to understand from an emotional perspective, to understand how to determine truth. And perhaps if we sort of give some examples there again. Every single time something rebels against us emotionally, in other words, we feel like that's not right, that's not just, that's not loving, then it's highly likely that we need to examine it, right, under those circumstances. Now, it could be that our sense of justice is skewed, that our sense of love is skewed. So that's the very first place we need to call, if we feel that those emotions. And then, if we're not connected to God on those particular subjects, it's highly likely we'll find out that our sense of love is skewed or our sense of justice is skewed. But once we've gone and actually maintain a connection with God, with God's love, we'll be able to determine quite rapidly what the truth will be on any given subject.
Yeah, obviously, sometimes even some of our sense of justice and logic is very skewed, isn't it? Even someone saying the truth to another person, often people feel that that's not loving and they have an internal rebellion.
Exactly.
And this is where you're saying we need to analyse really what's going on for us emotionally before we assess.
Exactly. Yeah. So if we logically assess it, we go, okay, all the person was doing was telling me what they believe is the truth. And if the person, the feeling, we've got to analyse the feeling. Were they trying to do that because they're trying to attack us or trying to pull us down? Or were they, what's their history? What's their history been? Have they always been loving, you know, the way they delivered it? Were they yelling and screaming when they delivered it, you know? Or were they being condescending or you know, were they being arrogant when they were delivering it? Were they being condescending towards us? Were they trying to ridicule us and make us feel bad? Well, no. Then all he did or she did was try to tell us the truth. If I feel bad about the reception of it, so let's say it was a husband and a wife, and the wife goes up to the husband and says, look, do I look fat in these jeans? And the husband goes, yeah, you look pretty fat in those jeans. And in fact, you've been looking pretty fat lately, actually, you know, like. And if he delivered it in that way with love and care for her, then if she gets all upset about it, then she's got to first go into, well, what's my, why have I gotten so upset?
Yeah.
And most of the time, our worth is tagged into our body weight, it seems, sometimes. And as a result, we'd have to work through why that has happened.
Yes.
What particular thing has happened to cause that emotional experience. And we have to understand that that would have to be an error from God's perspective. So there's ways that we can determine what is true and what isn't true by asking ourselves those particular things. But if a person comes to us and they're yelling and screaming and abusing us and, you know, ridiculing us and trying to pull us down and attack us, and we feel all of that, then it's highly unlikely that we need to even listen to what they've got to say from God's perspective, because they're not in a place where they can tell us any truth. They're not in a place where they can show us any truth. You know, these are emotions that they're going through that are out of harmony with love and out of harmony with, you know, God's universal laws of love. And as such, we can dismiss the fact that we need to actually listen to those particular people, right, in that moment. Mind you, there are times when people get upset and angry when they actually have a point. So if we were truly loving to ourselves, we would ask ourselves, do they have a point? And we would work through that issue personally.
Yeah.
But we wouldn't respond with, you know, rage ourselves. Because every time we respond with rage ourselves, it's an indication there's an emotional error inside of us that we need to look at. So look at it. Allow yourself to go through the rage, not directed at the other person. Go home, feel the rage, feel the experience. Get to the fear and the grief that is underneath that you're trying to deny, mm-hmm. emotionally trying to deny. Go that direction.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way to solve these particular problems. It's the only way to find out or bring yourself into more harmony with God's laws.
Mm. Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. Yeah. Quality 14. What do you mean when you say personal truth must be faced before divine truth can be found?
Yes, probably the best way to say that would be personal error must be faced before divine truth can be found.
Yeah.
Because most of the time the thing that prevents us from receiving divine truth into our soul is the error that we're in on particular subjects, whatever those subjects are. Now, what I mean by that is that we need to understand that our soul is exercising, while it retains the error, it is exercising its will to resist God's truth.
Mm.
And unless we are willing to face our personal error, what we believe is true inside of ourselves that's actually error, and remember it's an emotional experience, so we have to face it and experience it emotionally,
yep.
unless we're willing to do that, we will not be able to find God's truth on that particular subject. So this is basically how we use our will.
Mm-hmm.
We need to learn how to use our will to allow ourselves to face all of the things about ourselves inside of ourselves.
Yeah.
Now remember that this personal truth, or we could call it personal error, mm-hmm. depending on what type it is, exists as emotions, desires, passions, longings. It exists as intentions within the soul. It doesn't exist as an intellectual concept.
Yeah.
It exists inside of our soul. That's the thing that's preventing us from receiving more of God's truth.
Mm.
So we have to face what's really inside of our soul, not what we want to be inside of our soul. Or what we'd prefer to see inside of our soul, or what we hope is inside of our soul, or what we hope everybody else thinks is inside of our soul, or any of those things. Instead, what we need to do is face what is really inside of our soul.
Mm-hmm.
What is really there. What is really there as our intentions. What are our real intentions? Not what we hope to think our intentions would be, or what we hope that everybody else believes our intentions are, but what they actually are. And what about the condition of love that's inside of my soul? Not what we hope it to be, not what we hope everybody else thinks it is, but what it actually is. That's what it means to face the personal truth and error.
Mm-hmm.
And we must, this quality 14, basically is saying we must face this truth and error inside of our soul before we can receive God's truth about any particular subject inside of our soul. Until then, we're just hearing the words. So this has been the problem for many people coming along to our seminars, is they come along to the seminars and they hear the words. And I speak a long time, as everybody knows by now. And so they hear a lot of words,
yeah.
and some of which they retain. But very little is retained because there is very little openness in the soul to examine the personal truth or the personal error that's within the soul from an emotional perspective.
Yeah.
And so it's like the truth is presented and it goes in one ear and, as the saying goes, out the other. It doesn't get stored anywhere very frequently because there's all these emotions of error inside, intentions and beliefs of error inside the soul that have yet to be experienced emotionally, that have to be experienced emotionally before the truth can enter. And we've got to learn to face this personal truth. Now, what I see a lot of people doing is they have a huge desire to know God's truth on a certain subject. And at the same time, they have no desire whatsoever to understand their personal error on the same subject. Now, this is not very conducive to receiving God's truth. Mm-hmm. Because unless you understand and feel and experience your personal error on that subject, you will not ever really know God's truth on that subject.
Yeah.
It's impossible, in fact, to know God's truth on a subject while your personal truth is still within inside of you dictating what the outcome is going to be. And it is an act of will, the use of your soul's will, to change that. At some point, you've got to be willing to examine yourself completely honestly, completely truthfully, with no holes barred. You've got to be willing to go through that process. The majority of people who hear divine truth are not willing to go through that process for many, many years. Mm-hmm. And the reason why is because they have all sorts of judgment about the process. They want to live a happy life. They think they can manage a happy life without releasing error, which is not actually true. So there's a lot of beliefs that are in the soul of the individual generally that prevents divine truth from entering them, no matter how much you speak it. So this is why I've spoken divine truth for some people for 5 years, and during that period of time, none of it has entered them. And that's because they have not been willing for it to enter them. There has been emotions inside of their soul that they're unwilling to experience that prevent them from experiencing or receiving the divine truth inside of their soul. And because the divine truth hasn't been received in their soul, nothing can change. And if nothing can change, then it means they become the same person they were 5 years ago.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then they go, this doesn't work. Well, of course it doesn't work if you use your will to block the process.
Yeah.
It's never going to work that way, yeah. Ever.
Yeah. I used to think, or used to say, that I felt this is such a beautiful system, that actually as God engages with us, as a very loving parent, He's desiring for us to know ourselves, and in order to know ourselves, we have to face ourselves. And I suppose, in all honesty, I used to feel that that's a beautiful thing. God loves us so much that He doesn't just want us to know Him.
Or to make out we know Him.
Yeah, but He actually wants us in that process of coming to know Him to actually find the beauty inside of ourselves and really heal ourselves.
Yes.
Now, living that, really,
yeah.
In all honesty, I find it very confronting to face some of the things that are actually inside of me,
yeah.
the emotions of error that are inside of me. And
yes, and they must be faced if we're going to receive more divine love and we're going to receive more divine truth.
That's
this quality is basically saying we must face these things we don't want to face.
Yeah.
In order to receive more love and truth, we must face them. And we must choose to do it from our heart, not from our head. We can't force it. We can't force the process. We have to go through the process as engaged from the longings of our soul to do it.
Mm.
So it has to be an emotional experience that we engage fully with awareness at the emotional level.
And again, intellectually, I can see how beautiful a design that is.
Yes.
I can see the beauty in that design, that God is actually asking us to develop our will in this very sincere way as we come to know Him.
Because it means we really change.
Yeah.
It means that we really grow. It means it's not all fake. It's not all just a facade. It's not all just learning something that we're not really interested in. We have to be interested in it to learn it.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of all of God's truths, is you must be interested in it with a passion to learn it. And in fact, there is a quality of the soul that says that if you're not with your passion interested in one of God's truths, you will not receive it.
Mm.
In fact, it's impossible for you to receive God's truths when you have no real interest in receiving them.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So from your notes here, you say, if our personal emotion is in opposition to divine truth, then we cannot feel divine love completely.
That's correct. So if we think of our personal emotions, remember our emotions, our intentions, our beliefs, our passions and desires, These are all what are a part of the soul. These determine the will of the soul.
Mm.
So when we use the term will or long for God's love, using your will to long for God's love, we're basically saying that we have to use our passions, our desires, our beliefs, our motivations, our intentions to in harmony with that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're saying. We're going to have to bring all of these things into harmony in order to have an expression of our will where we long for something.
Yeah.
Now, when we truly long for something, we will receive it. Most people forget that. They go, oh, I'd like to receive some love from God. No, I'm not really feeling anything. God mustn't want to give. No, you don't want to receive it yet.
Yeah.
You've got a block inside of your soul emotionally that prevents you from receiving it yet. Find the block. What is the block? One of the blocks could be just apathy, that you don't think it's going to be worth anything to you in the end. That can be a block.
Yeah.
There's all sorts of blocks. Another block could be feeling that it's not possible, that it's impossible. Another block could be disillusionment, you know. These are all blockages that we need to allow ourselves to feel before they'll release, and therefore allow, after they've been released, allow the truth to enter.
Yeah. You listed quite a few examples here. Should we go through
Yes, them? I feel so. Yep.
So if I believe myself to be worthless and unlovable.
Yes. So a lot of people say to me, I've longed for God's love, but I don't receive any. And I go, okay. Are you sure you long for God's love? Oh, yes, I long for God's love. Do you believe yourself to be worthless and unlovable? They go, yeah, I do. Well, if you believe that, how can you say you long for God's love? The real feeling coming out of your soul is, I'm worthless and unlovable.
And, yeah, right.
So that's the prayer. That's the statement going out to God. I'm worthless and unlovable. So what's that really saying to God? Don't bother loving me. I'm worthless and unlovable.
Mm. And this is where you're saying that that personal emotion is actually in opposition to divine truth.
It is in opposition to divine truth. From God's perspective, you are lovable and you're worth everything. You're worth you're more important to God than any other physical thing God's created other than other people's human souls.
Mm-hmm.
That's how important you are to God. So you're worth more than the sun. You're worth more than the earth. You're worth more than any other thing in creation, according to God, other than any other person.
Mm-hmm.
So while you're believing you're worthless and unlovable, you've now got an opposition emotion. Your emotion is in opposition to God's emotion. Now you're going to need, the only way you can get rid of an emotion that's in opposition to God's emotion is to feel the emotion. So you're going to have to feel why you feel worthless and unlovable. You're going to have to feel the pain of that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Once you feel the pain of that emotion, now when you have a longing for God's love, you're going, I'm worth something and I am potentially lovable. Would you be able to give me some love? And of course some love can flow into you in that place because you're now open to receiving it.
Because you're in harmony with divine truth on that issue.
Because you're in harmony with divine truth on the issue, but also because you now have an opening in your heart that's saying, I am worth something and I am worth being loved and I desire that love. Whereas before you were saying, I'm not worth anything. I'm not worth to be loved. I don't really want love. That's what your soul was really saying.
Yeah.
And at some point, your soul has to change what it's saying. It's not your intellect, remember, that prays to God. It's your soul. So you've got to be willing to change the feeling inside of your soul. And if the feeling inside of your soul is I'm worthless and unlovable, you cannot receive God's love in that place because it's in complete disharmony with truth from God's perspective. From God's perspective, you are worth everything and you're worth being loved. And until you're willing to give up I'm worthless and unlovable by feeling it, you will not receive the truth from God that you're worthy and lovable.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so that's an example of how your personal truth or your personal error has to be faced before God's truth can be found.
Mm-hmm. Okay, another example.
Mm-hmm.
If I believe I'm better than other people.
Okay, here I'm saying, my soul is saying, let's say in my soul there's a feeling in me, an arrogant sort of feeling of superiority. I'm better than you, I know more than you, I'm better, you know, I'm worth more than you know, to God than you are. I'm worth more to other people than you are. You know, that kind of a feeling. Well, that feeling is in direct disharmony with God's truth on the subject. Because God's truth is, you're worth the same as every other one of God's children. Not more, the same. That's God's truth. Mm-hmm. While you have inside of your soul this arrogant superiority feeling saying that you're worth more, you will not receive God's love. Mm-hmm. You cannot receive God's love, and you cannot receive God's truth in that place on that subject. God's truth is you're equal. That's God's truth, and you're not going to receive that. You're not. You're going to walk around with this sort of arrogant feeling of condescension and disapproval, superiority to over other people. You're going to walk around with that. Everyone around you is going to feel it. And God knows that you're out of harmony with God's laws. You're not going to receive God's love in that place. You might receive some nice pandering feelings from spirits or something like that who are not very good in their condition, but you're not going to receive God's love because you're directly, your soul is using its will to remain directly out of harmony with the truth. Now, how do I get rid of that? Only by feeling my own arrogance, feeling my own superiority, feeling how, where it came from, what got it there, why do I believe I'm so important, more important than everyone else? A lot of times it means that we were treated with a certain degree of favouritism when we were a child or something over other children and things like that. And so we grew up to believe that we are better mm-hmm. as a result. Or our intellect might be more clever than somebody else's, and so we believe we're better because of that. Or, you know, we have a certain scientific bent and we believe that's better than other people. Or whatever it is that it causes us to remain in this arrogant condition. Whatever it is needs to be felt and released. Because if it's not felt and released, this personal truth isn't felt and released, God's truth cannot enter you. God's truth, which is you're equal to the other person, won't enter you.
Okay, next one. If I believe that I can keep breaking God's laws without penalty.
Yes. I see a lot of people thinking that they're longing for God's love, not receiving anything, and then thinking that it's all God's fault, basically, that they're doing nothing wrong. Well, no, the fact that you're not receiving God's love when you think you're asking for it means you're either not asking for it in the way that God designed, or it means that you are already breaking God's laws, of which you're conscious of, and you have no intention to change. Mm. Right? And I see a lot of people in that state having no intention. You can speak to them like to you blue in the face about the particular subject they face, and they have no intention of changing it, and therefore their soul's will is being used to not face its own personal truth, it's not face its own personal condition. And in that moment, what's happening is they are blocking the reception of God's truth, they're blocking the reception of God's love as well. And that can continue I've seen it continue for thousands of years. Some of my friends from the first century are still in the hells because of that one particular problem.
Yeah.
Because they believe that they, you know, should be able to get away with breaking God's laws and also receive God's love and improve and be in a nicer space, in a nicer condition, in a nicer location in the spirit world. It doesn't work that way. None of God's laws allow it to work that way, in fact. Which is great, actually.
It is a good thing, isn't it?
It is a very good thing. And yet, the majority of people on earth believe they should be able to manipulate law. So you get the average person who gets caught for speeding, they want to get away, you know, find a way out of it. The average person wants to manipulate their way out of something happening. You can't manipulate any of God's laws. Once you've broken the law, the penalty is automatically imposed. Bang, bang. There's nothing you can do about it. You can't go to God and say, look, I'm sorry. Can you just let me get away with that? I'll do better next time. None of that. None of that will work with God.
Yeah.
And most people on earth think that it will. And they think that it will because they've been brought up with that. You know, they got away with things with their parents when they were little. They got away with things in society as they were growing up. So they now think that they should be able to get away with things depending on what they believe is right or wrong.
Yeah.
You can't stay in that state and receive God's truth. Mm. It's impossible.
I've heard recently quite a few people that we know saying, well, yeah, I've got that issue, but hey, I'm in a pretty good space emotionally, or I'm no worse than anyone else here. And that's really a way of just avoiding the laws that they are consciously breaking, isn't it?
Yeah, and I feel quite sad for a person who says that I'm no worse than anyone else here, because basically what they're saying is everyone else here is in the hills, because that's basically the general condition of the Earth's population, and I'm no worse. Well, I don't think that's a fantastic thing. Do you know what I mean? I wouldn't be bragging about that. I'd be saying, yeah, I'm no worse. That means I'm not in a lower hell than everyone else. But you're still in the hells.
Yeah.
Like, what's the point of that when you could be, you know, acting in harmony with love? And those kind of comments come from people who are using their soul's will to have no desire whatsoever to grow in love. They just want their current addictions met, and they have no desire to grow in love, otherwise they wouldn't say those particular things.
Yeah.
A person who truly wants to grow in love never says those things, in fact.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, here's another example, perhaps a little bit more confronting. A person suffering child abuse who refuses to work through the issue emotionally.
Yes, so this is one of the difficulties that a lot of people on Earth face, right, being abused as a child, either violently or sexually. The problem with such abuse is this, that we grow up trying to stay away from it emotionally. We grow up trying to disconnect from it emotionally. Now, the only problem with that is our soul is using its will to disconnect from its own emotion. Now, if God's truth can only be experienced emotionally, it will be impossible for the emotional experience of God's truth to enter that soul while that person is denying its own emotional experience. Mm-hmm. In order to grow towards God, this person who's been abused will need to choose to feel its emotional experience of what happened in its past. Now, that can be quite a difficult process to go through, but essential, because if it doesn't do it, it's going to be in denial of its own emotion and therefore in denial of any new emotional experience. And the soul isn't built, as I've discussed in the How the Soul Functions series of questions and answers, the soul isn't built to selectively choose one emotion over the other. Mm. If you choose to shut down a large portion of your life, and a person who's choosing to shut down from abuse generally is shutting down their entire sexual life and their entire life with regard to fear, that's a huge area. They are huge areas of shutdown, and we cannot expect to continually receive God's love while we remain in that condition. We're going to have to open to those emotions. Now, while a person may want some help doing that or want to go to a therapist to get some help to do that, they can still do it all with God by themselves, but they'll need to be willing to go through the process. So the process of feeling our emotions is independent of who caused them, whether we caused them through our own choices or whether somebody else caused them. If we choose, using our will, to shut down the emotional experience, we are not going to face our personal truth. And if we don't face our personal truth, God's truth cannot enter us.
Yeah.
God's love also cannot enter us under those conditions.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. It's often quite confronting for people, isn't it? And
yes.
You see a lot of people holding on to things from the past.
Yes.
Because they feel, I didn't do it. Why should I have to go through it?
And when you think about it, that is really an angry statement. It is a state of anger, going, I didn't do it to myself, so I shouldn't now have to go through it, is really being angry with the person who did do it. And it's really being angry with God or anything externally. So you're going to have to own and feel those emotions. When you start feeling those emotions, you'll start receiving some love. Mm. That's the reality, because God's truth can enter you. You get to the point where you realise that, I realise all of a sudden that without my feeling of my emotions, no one else can do it for me. No one else can actually feel my emotions for me. No one else can have my experience. And once you realise that, you realise that all of the emotions that are stored within you, whether they came from your own poor choices in your life or from somebody else abusing you or harming you, all of those emotions are now in you, and only you have the power to release them. Nobody else can do that for you. And in fact, that now gives you the power to change. If it was dependent upon other people, then it might be even dependent upon the person who've abused you, which would mean that you'd have to wait until they change before you change, and that wouldn't be very fair.
No.
The way God's made this system is that you must change for God's love to enter you. Mm-hmm. For somebody else to have God's love enter them, they must change. And God's made this system very wisely,
yes,
so that allows you to get total control over your own personal life. So that's a very good thing, actually.
It is, yeah. And something that I think not many people think of.
Not at all, because when you're in a state of anger and you feel like you want to blame other people, you often don't think about this, the other side of the issue from God's perspective, and that is the truth that God created everything perfectly so that you, between you and God, can have a relationship and you need no one else.
Yeah.
And that's fantastic.
Yeah.
You don't need a priest. You don't need the abuser to repent. You don't need anybody who's harmed you to repent. You just need to go through your own process of forgiveness and repentance with God.
Mm.
That's all.
Okay, a couple other points that I think you've sort of covered. We cannot avoid the feelings of personal truth and at the same time receive divine truth.
Yes, so that's fairly obvious. If while I'm trying to avoid my personal truth and remembering that my personal truth is emotional, desires, passions, intentions, mm-hmm, belief systems, everything that's inside of me, and while I'm avoiding the reality of it,
yeah,
avoiding being honest about what's there, God's truth can't enter me because God is honest about what's there. So while I'm avoiding honesty about what's inside of me, I am in direct opposition to God's truth entering me.
Yeah.
Right? I'm using my soul's will to block the reception of divine truth.
Mm. Yeah. It's really so simple, isn't it?
And yes. Yet,
and as you've mentioned previously, simple for a child to do, to be honest.
Yes.
And yet we create all of these blocks towards such a simple process, don't we?
Yes, it's simple, but as an adult who's learned over many, many years to deny the truth about themselves in particular, learned over many years to shut down their emotions, learned over many years to deny love, you know, obviously there's going to be a lot of blockages to the process as an adult, which, although it's a simple process, it becomes a hard process, not easy, because of all of these blockages. So we're going to need to work our way emotionally through all of these emotional blockages, all the anger that we have about doing it, and then all the fear we have, and then eventually the grief will flow out of us. And once that really happens, then the receiving process is very, very easy.
Mm, mm. Okay, final one you had here. Feelings that oppose love and truth must be released by experiencing them before God's truth can enter us as a feeling and experience.
Exactly. So this is just an extension of what we've been saying. Feelings of love and truth that are out of harmony with love and truth are the blockages.
So just again, feelings that are out of harmony with love and truth
are the blockages.
Yep.
To receiving God's truth and receiving God's love. Right? So the only way that I can let go of these feelings that are out of harmony with truth and love that exist inside of me is to feel them. Now, it doesn't make them true. It just means that I have to feel the error that's being created that now exists within my soul.
Mm.
Once I feel this error, now the error leaves me and the wall that blocks me from receiving truth has now been deconstructed. So now there is no wall and truth can flow easily as soon as I long for it. If I have a sincere longing for it, the truth and God's love will flow. But I need a sincere longing for it still. So I need to let go of the error, and to do that I'm going to have to sincere desire to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to let go of the error and then I'll have to choose to long for the love and truth from God before the truth can enter me.
Yeah.
And that is me facing my personal truth, so that I can then receive more truth from God. And that means me letting go of all the things that are error inside of me that prevent me from receiving this truth from God.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. Great.
Good.
Regarding quality 14, yep. What does a soul-based understanding that personal truth must be faced before divine truth can be found look like in my personal life?
Well, firstly, I'd be always seeking to know what's really going on inside of myself. Not what I hope's going on inside of myself or hope everybody else sees or what the facade is, but actually know what is really going on inside of myself by feeling it. Mm-hmm. I would not avoid that process of feeling what's going on inside of myself. I would want to know more about myself. Whether somebody who's in a better condition of love than I can tell me, that'd be fantastic. I would actually look forward to them telling me rather than trying to avoid what they say.
Yeah.
I would allow the law of attraction to expose to me through the law what my real condition is. So instead of ignoring what happened today, I'd be looking at what happened today. You know, what does this show me about my soul that's out of harmony with God's truth, that's out of harmony with God's love? What inside of my soul is causing these particular problems? So, and it could be two sets of issues. It could be issues relating to being attacked all the time, which is an issue of self-love, or it could be the issue where we're willing to attack others or harm others, and that's an issue of loving others.
Mm.
And either one we would need to address. We would look at honestly what went on inside of our soul, and we would look at what we've attracted during the course of the day with regard to everything, from the way insects integrated with us right the way through to the way other humans, you know, worked with us. And we would examine everything. We would examine what's going on in my relationship with God. Have I received divine love today? Because if I haven't, then it means that I'm blocked. I need to face some personal truth. Yeah. There's some more truths that I need to discover about myself. Pray about wanting to know what are the truth or is the truth on a certain subject or are the truths regarding our entire person. Pray about knowing those particular things. Develop a personal longing inside of yourself to know. That's what you would do if you lived in harmony with this quality. You would realize without going through this process of finding out what I really am like, God's truth can't enter me. God's truth is what I really am like.
Mm-hmm.
When God's truth enters me, it'll tell me what I'm really like. If I'm resisting knowing what I'm really like, how can God's truth enter me? It can't. So I would see this as a primary priority in my life. I wouldn't put it on the back burner and just try to have fun every day and do a two-minute analysis, you know, at the end of the day. My whole life will be focused on trying to bring my life into harmony by feeling what's going on inside of me as it really is, not as I hope it to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, do you want to talk about some of the things from your notes? You've covered a lot of this in your intro. I have a strong desire to see myself as God sees me rather than deny or ignore my emotional truth.
Yeah, so we've got to remember that God's truth is how God sees the universe. Now, because you're a member of the universe, you're in the universe, God's truth is also going to be about how God sees you.
Yeah.
Now, if you're unwilling to feel about how God sees you, then you're not going to be in harmony with God. And if you're not in harmony with God, you're not in harmony with God's laws and you're not in harmony with God's love. So you can't expect to receive God's love or God's truths in that space.
Yeah.
So at some point, you're going to have to come to terms with the fact how God sees you is the most important thing.
Yeah.
So I need to know, how does God see me? I need to start to try to understand it intellectually. But more importantly, once I see that how I feel about myself is not the way God sees me, then I'm going to have to change a feeling inside of myself. And that's going to have to be something that I choose to use my will to do. No one else is going to force me to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to have to choose to use my will to do it.
Yeah.
And that means that, you know, I'm not going to get pushed by somebody into doing it. I don't have to get helped by somebody to do it. I need to choose to do it for myself. Now, if I did that, I would be living more in harmony with this quality in that I understand that this personal error is a major blockage to my relationship with God. And if I really badly want my relationship with God, I am going to want to know what my personal errors are.
Okay, I do not resist what God is showing me through the law of attraction, rather I embrace it.
Yes.
You talked about this.
Then let's talk about it a little bit more. Embracing the law of attraction is a lot different than what most people do. What most people do is resist almost totally what the law of attraction has brought them in a particular day. Remember, the law of attraction operates upon your soul. So it's really telling you what your soul's real condition is. But what most of us finish up doing is we create a life where we circle ourselves with comfort. We don't engage anything out of the normal, and that's what we're used to. And the reason why we do that is it helps us avoid what we've attracted, what we would normally attract if we didn't engage this comfort. And that's why when we go travelling, for example, we get more triggered, more emotionally unstable generally. The reason why is because there is more opportunity for us to notice the differences as to what the law of attraction is bringing us based on what our soul condition is. So we need to be engaging new things in the course of a day, doing new things, engaging new people, doing all sorts of other things in the course of a day. If we truly love the law of attraction in this case, what we would do is we want to engage it. We wouldn't be spending our life trying to avoid it. We wouldn't be spending our life afraid of it. Mm-hmm. We'd be wanting to engage it because it's God's messenger of truth to us. It tells us what God feels about us. Remembering that all of God's laws are perfect and therefore all of the operation of the law of attraction is perfect, it's telling us the truth about ourselves. So if we're getting attacked, for example, it's telling us that we don't love ourselves very much. If we're attacking other people and other people getting angry about our attack of them, then it's telling us that we're not very loving to other people very much. Mm-hmm. And we need to see these issues of love as they truly are, errors within our soul, and allow ourselves to release them. And in fact, if we really understood this quality, we would want to see them and we'd want to release them. We wouldn't want to avoid them.
Yeah. Okay, I do not try to falsify a position of divine truth when I know my personal truth is very different.
Yes, so in other words, I don't try to fake it until I make it, which is a saying that in the world that's very prominent, and very prominent in New Age movements, fake it until you make it. It's also very prominent in most religions, fake it until you make it type of thing, fake it until you believe it, or until it becomes a part of yourself. It's not the way to proceed. God is never fake with us. God knows your real condition. The best course of action with God is to not fake anything and to be who you really are and see who you really are, warts and all. And that, if that means seeing a whole heap of bad things about yourself initially and having to come to terms with that, then allow yourself to do that. Mm-hmm. Stop trying to falsify yourself with God. It's not going to work. God already sees everything. And God's waiting for you to see what God sees. That's part of you receiving God's truth, you seeing what God sees. So allow yourself to go through this acknowledgement of what's really inside. Allow yourself to see what God is seeing inside of you. Now, God sees a lot of good things that you can't see, and God sees also a lot of things that are not very nice that you think are fine. That's the reality. So God sees positive things about you that you think are negative, and God sees negative things about you that you think are positive. And you're going to have to change on both positions if you're going to become in harmony with God's truth.
Okay. I do not try to hide from myself or others my true desires, even when they are unloving.
Yes. So in other words, I allow myself to go, wow, I really don't like that person. And I don't hide that from myself. I don't try to make out that I do like them.
Yeah,
I don't like them. Let me feel why I don't like them. What's going on inside of me that causes me to not like them? Yeah. What's the emotion that's driving me? What's my personal error that's inside of me that causes me to hate my brother or dislike my brother or not enjoy their company or whatever it is? Mm-hmm. What's going on inside of me? When I'm truly in harmony with this quality of facing personal truth, I'm going, wow, that's true. I feel like that about that person. Wow, that's not very loving, but it's not a judgment of myself. I've got to go, okay, I'm not very loving there. What do I want to do about it? Do I want to feel the reason why I'm not very loving? Or do I want to ignore this and just make out that I'm fine?
Yeah.
Now, as soon as you choose to ignore, you've got to understand the ramifications. You choose to ignore, you can't receive divine love anymore and you won't receive divine truth anymore until you choose to acknowledge.
Mm.
That's the way God's laws work with regard to the human soul and truth and love.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm choosing to ignore what I really am inside, I am automatically blocking the flow of love and truth from God into my soul.
Mm.
And I've got to see that rather than try to make out that everything's fine. And the best way to see that is look at your life today and then look at your life 2 or 3 or 4 years ago and ask yourself, have I really changed? Do I feel differently? Do I feel more loving? Am I treating people more loving? Do I feel more positive? Am I treating people more positively? Do I feel more desire for truth? Am I longing for truth more? Do I feel more desire for God's love? Am I longing for God's love more? And have an honest assessment of yourself today and yourself 4 years ago. How much time do you spend, you know, doing those particular things? And most people will find that 4 years ago and today there's very little difference aside from their location, perhaps, or the person they're with or whatever. But aside from that, there are usually many of the same feelings inside of the soul as there was 4 years ago. Now, if that's the case, it means that during that four-year period of time, you have not faced much personal truth. You have been unwilling to face personal truth. The primary reason why you haven't grown, the only reason, in fact, why you haven't grown is because you haven't wanted to know about yourself. So stop that. Stop not wanting to know and start wanting to know. You know, start absorbing the truth about yourself.
Yeah.
God's got plenty of things in the universe telling you the truth about yourself.
Minute by minute.
Minute by minute.
Yeah. Presumably in that what you're saying about not hiding yourself or your real feelings, presumably there's sort of three conditions we can be in. One is the facade and really wanting to hide that from everyone and ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The second is sort of what you referred to, which is acknowledging it and like taking responsibility for it.
Feeling your injured self.
Yeah.
But wanting to still be your injured self. A lot of people stay in that place.
Okay, that's the one I was getting to.
Yeah. See, I feel like there's the facade, which is not even wanting to know what you really feel. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yep.
Making out that you're someone different than you really are.
Yep.
That's always going to be a problem. But then there's a second thing where you're actually feeling your injuries but not wanting to actually do anything about them. Not wanting to change, not wanting to grow in love, you want to rebel, you know, in that place a lot of times.
Mm.
To me, that's feeling the injured self without any desire to become more loving.
Yeah, and I suppose I see people being quite abusive in that state
because very abusive.
They abuse the principle of truthfulness and say, well, no, I've given up my facade. This is how I am right now.
Yeah, I'm just a bitch and I don't care. You've got to put up with it. And that's very unloving. In fact, what you're doing is more damage to your soul in that place.
And telling people truth.
Yeah, going around saying, you're this and you're that, you're this, you're that. And not even examining truthfully your own personal motive for doing so, which most of the time is to pull them down so that you feel better about yourself, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, the reality is you're not being very honest about yourself in that place, really. You're still in a facade in some ways.
Yes.
You're not really feeling your own causal emotion. So most people start being honest about their causal emotion but still choose to not feel it.
Mm-hmm.
To truly be honest about your own emotion inside of you, you have to feel it.
Yeah.
So a lot of people have a facade and then they get out of their facade and start to see what they feel, like they start to feel what they feel, but they have no desire to truly feel it.
Mm-hmm.
They have a desire to rebel against it and, you know, get angry at the world and all that stuff. That's improvement over a facade, but it's not more loving.
Yeah.
Right? The reality is you're now in a destructive phase, and if you continue on your path of destruction, your soul's going to get even darker. if you stay in that destructive phase. So it's not very helpful for the development of your soul or progress in love. You need to get out of that and go into this willingness, a desire to feel your true self. That's a desire to feel your injured self, your true injuries, without blaming anyone else, without projecting it on other people, without damaging other people with it. That place, very few people have reached at this point.
Yeah, and perhaps it's for another discussion, but I feel there's a lot of blockages and things people come up against in moving to that ultimate third state, which is really facing personal truth, which is humility.
I don't feel that's the ultimate state. The ultimate state is the fourth state, which is coming to see yourself as God sees you completely without any injuries.
Of course.
That's the real state that we were created in, the state that we can grow towards, and the state that we can become at one with God in.
Yeah.
So that's where we're headed. But you can't go to that state without, you know, by jumping some of the others, generally.
Yeah.
Of course, I do feel you can jump the state where you feel the injuries and then go, stuff the world, I'm just going to stay in these injuries. You can certainly jump that state. That's just an exercise of your will.
Yeah, I'd like to talk to you sometime about that, because I often see people in that second state without seemingly any sense of morality or ethics.
I agree. Which is a huge problem if they ever want to become more loving.
Yeah. Hmm. Or on the other hand, where I suffer is where I see that and then I judge myself.
Yeah, which is also not ethical.
No, because I'm treating myself badly.
Well, not just because of that. The majority of people have errors within them because of somebody else doing something to them. There's only two reasons why we have errors within them generally. One is that we've made choices that are out of harmony with love, or two, that other people have made choices towards us that are out of harmony with love. Now, for the majority of us, we have a mixture of those things. So if you judge yourself, you're not always honouring the second thing, which is that other people may have damaged many of the things that are now damaged within you.
Mm.
And you're not being truthful about that. So that's not ethical either. To be ethical, you've got to be balanced right across the board. That means that I am responsible for only the things I chose to do out of harmony with love. Other people are responsible for what they chose to do out of harmony love towards me. I am responsible for feeling all of my emotions. I need to choose to feel both sets of emotions.
Mm.
So, you know, these are the things we need to understand if we're truly going to be facing our personal truth.
Yeah. Okay. I have a willingness to be humble at all times, seeing that my personal truth is often not loving.
Yes. So humility, remember, is this, firstly, the ability to feel all of your own emotions, whether they're loving or unloving. Secondly, humility allows you to examine yourself honestly as God sees you. So it's a desire to examine yourself as God sees you. Now, if we examine ourselves, how God sees us, and we find ourselves, oh, there we see something, humility would also then, by extension, go, I want to feel why I feel this. I would want to go through the experience of feeling this error so that it can leave me. Humility would dictate that. So while many people have heard the definition of humility, very few are practicing it. Because to practice humility, you have to feel. You have to have an emotional experience. And this is where most people fail when it comes to the path towards God. That's why religions got created, in fact, because many people did not want to feel. And then as a result, they want to believe rather than feel.
Mm-hmm.
They want to believe in something rather than feel what they have to go through to become more loving themselves. And they don't understand that the true religion from God's perspective is love. That's the true religion. Now, that's not a doctrine. If you want to think of it a different way, it might be called a doctrine of love, but it's not a human doctrine.
Yeah.
It's God's definition of love. That's what true religion is. And if we choose to not feel, we are automatically choosing to be out of harmony with that definition.
Mm. Mm. Okay, final one.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that I must release my personal truth error to get closer to God.
Yes. So I must release my personal truth, or let's say the truth doesn't have to be released, really, does it? So I have to release the personal error in order to get closer to God. Mm-hmm. I know and understand that. If I live this quality, I know and understand that with all my soul. I understand, wow, I can't get closer to God by acting differently, by taking some different actions, by saying different words, by ignoring truth about myself. I can't get closer to God. The only way I can get closer to God is by feeling my own personal emotions and feelings, which are my personal truths, if you like, even though they might be truth and error. I'm prepared to feel them. Mm-hmm. That's the only way I'll get closer to God. And that's what I need to remember from this quality. If I allow myself to go through that process, I will always come out of it in a new state. I will always be closer to God. I will always be closer to truth. I'll always be able to love more easily. If I'm still finding love very difficult and hard to achieve, I'm still not understanding God's truths, I'm still certainly not acting in harmony with God's laws, then it means that I'm finding love real hard. Yeah. And the only reason why I find love hard is because there's something inside of me that causes it. And so I need to choose to feel that particular thing. And if I understood this principle, I would choose to feel it. I would choose to face it because I want to get closer to God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you mean by saying we need to be totally immersed in truth?
Well, this is a state that I feel that many people who first hear about divine truth and divine love don't understand very much about, because they don't understand the sincerity of the state. And this is being so committed to understanding not only external truth but internal truth that you spend most of the time in your day-to-day life investigating it. So I think the average person who hears anything spiritual generally spends very, very little time investigating it. What they might do is they spend a bit of time hearing it, and then they don't spend much other time. They just get involved in their day-to-day life till the next day or the next few days, and then they look at it again and do the same thing. When you're totally immersed in truth, it's not like that. If you really desperately want to have a relationship with God and you desire that relationship with all your heart, you will want to be totally immersed in truth every single day of your life. You want to know what God's truth is every single day of your life. Mm. You won't be avoiding it any single day of your life. You won't try to have a happy day in order to avoid it. You won't also try to have a sad day in order to avoid it. You won't try to do anything in order to avoid discovery of more truth. You won't create your lifestyle so that it avoids the confrontation of truth. You won't stop being with different people who avoid the confrontation of truth. Right? To avoid the confrontation of truth. You will engage every single thing that happens in your life, every email, every Facebook interaction if you have Facebook, every personal interaction with a person, every phone conversation, every interaction with nature, every interaction with your day-to-day life at work and at home, every interaction with your children, your parents, your family, your close associates, your extended associates and general people in the world, every interaction will be you wanting to know more truth. That's what it means to be totally immersed in truth. Now, the average person, I feel, who even hears about divine truth is not engaged in discovery of truth in that manner. Remember, to do it, you would also have to engage it understanding all of the qualities of divine truth that we've just discussed, all the 14 qualities and attributes you would want to engage in this process.
Yeah.
Majority of people don't want to do that.
No, just a single one can be quite confronting.
Exactly. For the majority, we're lucky if we even are engaging one of the aspects or qualities of God's truth in our day-to-day life, let alone the whole 14 every single day.
Yeah. In your notes here, you've written some statements that are actually what it would be like if I was totally immersed in truth. So perhaps I could read them and just you could comment. So, if I'm totally immersed in truth, I've learned that when I act in complete harmony with what I know to be God's truth, I'm also acting in complete harmony with God's laws of love. This means that I give each situation I'm personally involved in the best potential for the best possible outcome.
Mm. I feel this is very important as, an exercise of our will. What I notice people doing is they almost explain away why they have acted out of harmony with what they know love to be. You know, they say things like, oh, I'm not that developed yet, or oh, well, in this situation, I didn't feel it applied, or, you know, there's all sorts of internal justifications that people have. When we have when we're totally immersed in truth, we understand the importance of truth in our day-to-day life, so much so that we see that every time we act in harmony with truth, we're acting in harmony with law. That gives every single event that you're personally involved in the best possible outcome.
For everyone involved.
For everyone involved. Yeah. Not only yourself, but every single person involved, who's involved in your life in that particular interaction. You, by engaging this particular law, have honoured the fact in your soul that you are giving everybody the best possible gift, mm-hmm. every single person around you. Now that, to me, is a wonderful show of whether a person is acting in harmony with truth or am totally immersed in truth. Instead, what I see happening a lot of times is people justify the error constantly. Mm-hmm. They justify why they should continue believing the error. They justify why they should continue acting the error, acting out of harmony with love and acting out of harmony truth. They say things like, oh, it's not a perfect world and I'm not perfect yet, mm-hmm. as a justification of acting out of harmony with love and out of harmony with truth. These are all signs that you're not totally immersed in truth, because if you were, you would not be ever saying these particular things.
And there's a big lack of understanding that every step we make towards God's truth and acting in harmony with that truth actually maximises positive potentials for everyone.
Exactly.
And
so
also,
it's the most loving thing we could do.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
And that is the thing that I feel a lot of people are forgetting about truth. When they act, you know, by dishonestly, or they don't tell the truth, or they don't act in harmony with the truth, they are basically choosing to not love.
Mm.
And every time you choose to not love, you are damaging your soul.
Yeah.
You're actually doing something more that you're going to have to, at some point in the future, compensate for.
Yeah.
So you can see why most people never reach at one with God while on earth, because in the course of a day, there's many justifications for choosing to act out of harmony with love, which means that even though they might have a longing for God's love in the morning, during the day, they're chosen to act out of harmony with it, which now has caused additional damage to the soul that would need to be compensated for.
Yeah.
And it's very, very damaging to yourself and to other people, of course.
Yeah. I know it, just observing others and even from my own life, sometimes we just come up to a relatively small fear, and in that moment we choose to dishonour what we know to be truth,
exactly.
or God's laws in that situation. And actually, by doing that, by stepping away from just perhaps short term, I sometimes say to people, like, 3 seconds of discomfort, really, we actually create like 3 months of difficulties, law of compensation, having to look at what went on.
Yep.
And we actually, the converse is true, isn't it? When we act in harmony with truth, we maximise the positive potentials.
Yep.
When we choose to ignore what we already know because we want to avoid a little bit of discomfort maybe,
yep.
Then we actually generate a whole heap of negative possibilities for everyone involved.
Not only that, those negative possibilities could potentially go on for months and even years and even centuries.
Yep.
Depending on the different choices that people make.
Yep.
So this is what we need to understand about error. Error not only causes a problem in the moment, it causes a problem for the rest of the person's life until the error is addressed. Whereas truth not only has a benefit in the moment, but it has a benefit to the person the rest of their life.
And everyone else.
And yeah. everyone else.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
And if we really were to, if we understood that about truth, we would never avoid it.
No.
Never avoid it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, next one.
Mm.
I've learned to be in personal truth at all times, with all people, and under all circumstances, no matter what the potential outcome will be, because I will then be in harmony or be brought into harmony with God's laws, which support my acting in harmony with love and truth.
Mm. So when we look at this particular subject, what is it that you feel like about it when you read it?
Well, in the statement is inherent that it's at all times and with all people. There's no exceptions.
Yes.
So I'm it's across the board. I've made a decision when I'm immersed in truth that I will always be truthful. And also here you're saying I might be just truthful about my personal truth,
yeah.
and that might have to be corrected. But by engaging in this way, I allow the possibility of that correction to happen.
Exactly.
Rather than just avoiding it.
Exactly. So a lot of people use the excuse that, I didn't act that way because I don't know for certain whether that's true or not. Well, my suggestion is this. Do what you think is the truth at the moment, and then let the law, God's laws of truth, correct you if you're wrong.
Yeah.
Allow, and if you're humble, you would choose to do that. You would do the best with what you currently know.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't choose to not act. You wouldn't choose to avoid. You would choose to do the best with what you currently know. Then you would be open to change, showing you that maybe what you currently knew wasn't enough. And you would let yourself go through that process.
Yeah.
So it's a bit like the child when it gets up to walk. The child doesn't go to itself, I'm not going to try to walk because I'm going to fall over. The child says, I'm going to walk because there's a lot of advantages in walking. I can scoot around now. I don't have to wear out my knees. It's a lot easier to get around. I can climb higher.
Yeah.
There's a lot of advantages to walking. So the child doesn't choose to stay crawling, right, just because it's afraid of walking.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we look at the average person when it comes to truth, many times we choose to stay crawling when it comes to truth, rather than get up and walk because we're afraid of what walking might do.
Just afraid to fall over.
We're afraid to fall over. We're afraid to make a mistake. And honestly, living a life based around fear of mistakes causes a lot of damage to your soul.
Mm-hmm.
You're actually causing damage to your desires and intentions. You're causing damage to your passions. You're causing damage to your personality because you're suppressing your personality. So it's very, very damaging to your soul to choose to do that. Now, the child, when it gets to try to walk, it doesn't do that. It just gets up and it knows what it wants and it goes for it, even though it possibly knows that it might fall over doing it.
Mm.
It'll just get up and try again. And we often, as adults, don't have that same attitude because we're afraid of dealing with certain emotions.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. All right, next one.
Mm-hmm.
I've learned to state God's truth at all times, with all people and under all situations,
mm-hmm.
no matter what the potential outcome will be, when given the opportunity to do so by others and their own exercise of their own free will.
Yes. So this is saying, basically, that I choose at all times, in all circumstances, in all situations, to share what I know is God's truth on any matter.
And so this
is... I choose to live it.
This is...
In every situation. Go on.
Sorry. Presumably this is truth that we've felt because we can't receive it any other way.
Well, we wouldn't probably be living it without feeling. But even if it's something that we know to be true but don't feel just yet, I would still choose to do it.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reality. Because I honour the fact that I know it but not yet feel it. I know that there's errors in me that cause me to not yet feel it. But I would allow the process to expose the error.
Yeah.
So I would even choose to do it then. So if I know that yelling and screaming at somebody is not a loving thing, and yet I still feel like yelling and screaming, I wouldn't yell and scream at them because I would choose to do what God's truth would dictate to me in that particular situation,
yeah.
Not my own truth. My own truth would say, yeah, go and have a good yell and scream at them. God's truth says, no, don't do that. You're going to damage people that way. You're going to damage your own soul that way. But the second half is the important thing.
Yes, very important. Yeah.
So if we reread the second part of it.
When given the opportunity to do so by others, mm-hmm. and their exercise of their own free will.
Yes. Now, this is what many people forget. People give you an opportunity through the exercise of their will. You have no right to share truth with others, except when you're personally engaged in it. So in other words, if you're in my life, I now must share the truth, mm-hmm. right? Because it's my life. But if you're involved with, say, Igor, who's behind this camera in front of me at the moment, and you want to engage Igor with a certain truth, and it's none of my business at all, then I have to wait until you or Igor express a desire to know the truth,
yeah.
before I can share it with you.
Yeah.
That's honouring the free will of the individual. Yeah. So I notice very many things going on around us that are very much out of harmony with love and truth a lot of the times, and I say nothing until placed in the situation where one or more of the people involved has asked me about the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Then I say everything possible.
Yep.
That the circumstance and their will allow me to say.
Yeah.
While honouring my own love of myself in the process.
Yep.
And that's what we would do if we were totally immersed in truth.
Mm. Mm-hmm. All right. Point four, I've learned to live my life fearlessly in truth at all times. I'm no longer governed by personal fear. And personal fear becomes subordinate to the higher importance of living in harmony with God's truth.
Yes, this is an extremely important thing to understand. To be totally immersed in truth, we have to be prepared to subordinate our fear to God's truth.
Yeah.
Most people are not prepared to do this. This is the reason why the majority of people who have heard divine truth do not progress, is because they are unwilling to subordinate their own fear. In other words, if we draw it like a diagram or an illustration, imagine if God's truth is here, the majority of people have a certain level of fear associated with living or practicing that truth,
mm-hmm.
here. That means their fear dominates everything. The fear is not subordinate to the truth. The fear is the God. It's the thing that determines what will happen. And the truth is subordinate to their fear, unfortunately. What we need to do, and what we would do if we were totally immersed in truth, is we would subordinate purposefully the fear. We would make the fear be less important. We still might have a lot of it,
mm-hmm.
but we would view it as less important,
yeah.
than honouring the truth. Emotionally inside of us, we would feel that it's more important to honour the truth, even though I'm afraid.
Yeah.
Right, that's what we would do in every situation. So there's some situations that I'm very afraid still, because I've still got some fear in me about certain situations.
Mm-hmm.
And yet I still choose to engage the truth, because the way I see my fear is that I must always make it subordinate to the truth.
Mm-hmm.
I feel it. I let myself feel my fear still. I let myself honestly feel what it's about, but I still act in harmony with what the truth dictates and not in what my fear would dictate.
So, and really what I observe you doing is that there might be a level of fear within you, but because of your honour of truth and your embodiment of just about everything that we've talked about in this entire series, truth naturally, fear naturally becomes subordinate, not because you've released some fear, but because the truth is so honoured by you.
Yes, it's more important to me than anything.
Because the only way we can reduce our fear is to release it, isn't it? Mm. But we can still honour truth above that fear, can't
yes.
we?
Yes. Yeah. So this is about not where your fear level is.
No.
It's about where you place your honour of truth.
Yeah.
Now, most people I observe place their honour of truth below their fear. So in other words, they're prepared to be honest and truthful as long as they're not afraid.
Yeah.
Most people do not honour their truth above their fear. In other words, even though they're afraid, they're still truthful.
Mm-hmm.
Most people don't do that. The difference between myself and most people is that single difference, often times. The truth to me is of supreme importance. It is next to love, it is the most important thing in the universe. And in fact, in some ways, it's just as important as love, because it leads you to love.
Mm-hmm.
It leads you to a greater love.
Mm-hmm.
So you could say that love is dependent upon it, right? In some to a large extent, dependent
yeah.
upon you absorbing more truth. This is why truth is so important in your life. Now, if you place it as this very high priority in your life, number one priority in your life, you'll eventually be led to God, who will eventually become your number one priority. You'll be led to love. You'll be led to humility. You'll be led to a lot of other things if you place it as a high priority in your life and you honour it. It's when we dishonour it, or when we view our fear as more honourable or more important or as a high priority, that we get ourselves into extreme difficulties
mm-hmm.
when it comes to our progression. We also eventually choose to do things that are very damaging to our soul when our fear governs our actions. So to be totally immersed in truth, we have to learn to subordinate fear. And that doesn't mean to suppress it. You've got to feel it. You've got to feel the emotion of it, but not honour it, not do what it dictates. And that, I feel, is a very important part of being totally immersed in truth.
Mm. Well, that's all I have on my page to discuss with you today.
Yep.
It's been really enjoyable talking about the qualities of divine truth.
Yeah, so I just, as a general comment to everyone that's been listening about the qualities of divine truth, hopefully going through the qualities has enabled you to come to understand how God's truth actually works and how you personally can start to discover God's truth for yourself, because all of these attributes and qualities of God's truth are an important part of anything that's presented to you. So allow yourself to see what's presented to you in the world, whether it's a religious thought, a philosophical thought, a political thought, or any other type of teaching. Allow yourself to be presented it, and then analyse it through those qualities and ask yourself, does it have that quality about it? Does it have this quality about it? And you will find, if you do that, you will find it very much more easier.
More simple or easier?
Well, I feel like it would be a lot easier for you to come to determine what is God's truth in comparison to what is just mankind's ideas. The world is full of millions of ideas. The majority of them are mankind's ideas. None of them, men's ideas, you could say almost all of them are not God's ideas and therefore not God's truths. And so what we need to do is come to see how to determine what is God's truth in comparison to mankind's doctrines and ideas. And I feel if you just apply those 14 rules to anything you examine, you will be quite easily able to throw away a lot of things as not being God's truth, because they're just obviously mankind's ideas and they don't match the qualities of truth. And you will also be able to accept a lot of things that mankind doesn't accept, because they will become very plain to you as being God's truths. So hopefully this process will help this discussion has helped you go through that process in a much more active manner. So thanks for your time, and we'd like to thank Lena and Igor for their time doing our recording today. Thanks, guys.